moment was a real crisis. When I say a real crisis, it was a moment that could have broken everything up. To put it in the context of the Gospel of John, Jesus was an extraordinary person with power. He spoke with authority. He transformed water into wine, multiplication of the bread. He brought sight to the blind. And just prior to this, we see something extraordinary happening. Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. 4 days he had been dead. You can imagine the people around. Jesus must be the prophet. He's the Messiah. What extraordinary person he is. Previously, the day we call Palm Sunday, Jesus goes down into Jerusalem, Bethany. Historians say that there could be 2 million people in Jerusalem at that moment. 2 million. Jesus comes, and as we read the gospel, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. They have the palm, the leaves of the palm tree. You can imagine the excitement. 2 million people. Here is Jesus. He's the Messiah. He's going to liberate us. We have to remember how the Jews felt crushed by the Romans. I won't go into that. But here we come, Jesus coming into Jerusalem. Hosanna, Hosanna to the highest, Son of David. Excitement, liberation. We know that. Remember the disciples of Emmaus? We thought he would liberate us. He's been dead. We thought this. One of the great humiliations of Jesus, he disappointed us. Anyway, a few days later, there's that sacred meal. Jesus gets up, takes off his garment, outer garments, takes a basin, puts water in it, and starts washing the feet of the disciples. What? You left my feet? Not possible. The disciples were waiting to be part of the government of Jesus who had come to liberate. So they're very proud of themselves. Jesus kneels down. And he's going to wash the feet of Judas. So we're in a moment of crisis. You wash my feet? You don't know now. Later. No, you shall never wash my feet. No question. I wash your feet, yes, but you wash my feet. No! If I can't wash your feet, no more sharing between us. In other words, it says, if I can't wash your feet, there's the door. Could leave. I don't oblige you. Peter panics. not only my feet, but my head, my hand. Calm down. But we're in a moment of great crisis because the disciples were expecting a powerful Jesus. Now we're beginning to see a weak Jesus. To such an extent that Peter, a little bit later on that night, will say, I don't know that man. When the servant says, you're one of them, aren't you? I don't know that man. doesn't know a weak Jesus. He knows a powerful Jesus. He cannot accept a vulnerable and weak Jesus. He cannot accept. He wants power. He wanted a powerful Jesus. And here, Jesus on his knees. Not possible. I do not know this man. We can all live by an ideology and not reality. We can have an idea of what it should be. Reality. In front of a weak church, weak churches, we would like a strong one. We don't want a weak Jesus. That's Peter, not a weak. But Jesus says, if I cannot wash you, no more sharing. And Jesus is going to go from weakness to weakness. We have to remember an extraordinary text of 53 Isaiah. It's through his wounds that we are healed. It's through his wounds. It's through his weakness. And isn't that what Jesus said to Paul, who wanted absolutely the thorn out of his flesh? What as that thorn, books have been written about it, but that's not. But Jesus says, no, it's through your weakness that my power will be manifested. That be through the weakness of Jesus, to the moment where he'll be humiliated, abandoned, and in great pain. Humiliation of Jesus when his friends will have said, he has disappointed us. That is the pain of Jesus. He has disappointed us. But here is beginning this road. But up until then, he has been the master, he's been strong in words and in actions. Something new. The fragility of the Savior. Teaching us about our fragility. And in this particular area, where so many Christians being persecuted, laughed at, even in the press of our strong countries, how we can pretend the church has no more value. This is the reality of our world. Our world does not want God, does not want Jesus. So they can be mocked at, laughed at. Christians can be persecuted. Through your weakness, that my power will be manifested. The disciples are shocked. It's a crisis moment. Frequently during the retreats which I do, which we always have the washing of the feet, it's a sort of gentle moment, peaceful. The washing of the feet with Jesus was not peaceful. Judas is there. The spokesman, no, you'll never wash my feet. If I can't wash your feet, no more sharing between us. They are startled, upset, lost. Who is this Jesus? It's a problem of us all. Not just who is Jesus, and we can find this in the Gospels, but what is my relation to Jesus? What is the relation of the body to Jesus? That's the question. Sometimes people want a strong church. Yeah. But it's something else. We might have an ideology of what Jesus should be. But the reality, we know that reality. crucify Jesus. And we've been asked to follow Jesus. And many of you, you are in situations extremely painful. You know, maybe humiliated. Christians humiliated around the world, looked down on. Here's our teacher. And then having washed the disciples' feet, having washed both feet, Jesus takes his place, puts back in. Do you understand what I've done to you? Do you understand? You call me Lord and Master. And I am. So if I've washed your feet, you must wash each other's feet. And then he goes on, I've done this as an example for you. What I have done to you, you must do to one another. And then he goes on, Amen. Very strong when Jesus says, Amen. Very truly, Amen, I tell you. Servant is not more important than the master. The one who is sent is not more important than the one who sends. He's insisting, what I've done to you, you must do. That is clear. And then he goes on and says, it's a beatitude. Knowing this, if you do it, you will be blessed. It's a beatitude. And you know, the beatitudes are the road into the kingdom of God. The kingdom of love. If we live the Beatitudes, we enter into the kingdom of God. In our communities, we have a lot of people who cannot speak, cannot understand. And so, on Maundy Thursday, as we gather in our group or home to read the text, people won't understand it. They can't. So we live the text. And that's what Jesus tells us to do. Live it. Wash each other's feet. And maybe somebody on my left would have a severe handicap who washed my feet. Then I'll wash the feet. The person on my right. So we go around. We wash each other's feet. Why do we wash them? As Jesus tells us to. And maybe it's because each one of us, in some way, we want to become like Jesus. And I think Jesus was washing the feet. We read the text. The Archbishop has just read, having loved his own, he loved them to the end, to an extreme. So the washing of the feet is an act of love. I think Jesus takes the foot of each one, maybe says the name. He washes them not because they're dirty, obviously. He washes them to tell them something. He wants to tell each one, I love you, I love you. And each one, you have a mission to continue what I have done, to liberate the world from the power of the evil one. And I send you off, and I love you, and I'll always be with you. Something very beautiful. Jesus is washing the feet of these men who will break down because they don't understand. They'll understand. Jesus is saying to each one of you, I love you as you are, as you are, with your fragilities, with your beauty, with your gifts, with your tears and with your laughter. And Jesus then sent